One, he's never known anything like it. Two, he's never known anything to write home about. Three, just nothing to write home about. Home. What's the first thing you remember?
Let's see.
What's the first thing that comes into my head, you mean?
No.
No, no, what's the first thing that you can remember?
It's no good, it's gone. It was a long time ago.
No, you don't get my meaning. What's the first thing you can remember after all the things you've forgotten?
I forgot the question.
Are you happy?
What?
Are you content, at ease?
I suppose so.
What are you going to do now?
I don't know. What do you want to do?
Well, I have no desires. None! Wait, no, there was a messenger. That's right, we were sent for.
I'm sorry. What's the matter with you today?
We have been spinning coins together since, what? Well, I don't know when, and in all that time, if it is all that time, I don't suppose either of us has ever been more than a couple of gold pieces up or down. Now, I hope that doesn't sound surprising to you, because, well, it's very unsurprising. This is something I'm trying to keep a hold of. But the equanimity of your average tosser of coins depends upon the law, or rather, our probability. Let us say our tendency. You know, at very least, a mathematically calculable chance assures that he does not upset himself by losing too often, nor upset his opponent by winning too often. This made for a kind of harmony, a kind of confidence that related the fortuitous and the ordained into a reassuring union which we recognized as nature. The sun came up about as often as it went down in the long run, and a coin showed heads about as often as it showed tails. Then a messenger came. We have been sent for. Nothing else happened. 92 coins spun consecutively showed heads 92 consecutive times. And for the last 3 minutes, on the wind of a windless day, I've heard the sound of drum and flute.
Another curious scientific phenomenon is the fact that the fingernails grow before after death. As does the beard.
What?
Beard!
But you're not dead.
I didn't say they started to grow after death. The fingernails grow before birth, though the beard does not.
What?
Beard, what's the matter with you? Toenails, on the other hand, well, they don't grow at all.
The toenails, on the other hand, never grow at all.
Do they? It's a funny thing. I cut my fingernails all the time, and every time I think to do so, they need cutting. But now, for instance, and yet, to the best of my knowledge, I've never cut my toenails. They ought to be curled under my feet by now, but it doesn't happen. I never think about it. Perhaps I cut them absent-mindedly when I'm thinking of something else.
What's the first thing that you did today?
I woke up, I suppose.
No, wait! The man, the foreigner, he woke us up!
A messenger!
That's it!
A pale sky before dawn, a man standing on his saddle, bangs on the shutters and shouts, "What's all this row about? Clear off!" But then he called our names, you remember that? This man woke us up?
Yes.
We were sent for?
Yes.
And that's why we're here. Travelling?
Yes.
It was urgent. A matter of extreme urgency. A royal summons. Official business and no questions asked. Lights on in the stable yard and head off headlong and hot foot across the land. Our guides outstripped in breakneck pursuit of our duty, fearful lest we come too late.
Well, too late for what?
How do I know? We've not got there yet.
Then what are we doing here, I ask myself?
You might well ask.
Yeah, we better get on.
You might well think.
We better get on.
Right. On where?
Forward.
Which way did we... I knew all along it was a band.
You knew all along it was a band?
But here they come.
Halt! Halt! An audience! Oh, perfect! A lucky thing we came along.
For us?
Let us hope so. But to meet two gentlemen on the road, we would not hope to meet them off it.
No?
Well, next, in fact, and just in time.
Why is that?
Why, we grow rusty, and you catch us at the very point of decadence. By this time tomorrow, we might have forgotten everything we ever knew. That's a thought, isn't it? We'd be back where we started. Improvising.
Tumblers, are you?
Oh, we can give you a tumble if that's your taste, and, well, times being what they are. If not, for a jingle of coin, we can do you a selection of gory romances full of fine cadence and corpses pirated from the Italian. And, well, it doesn't take much to make a jingle. Even a single coin has music in it. Tragedians, at your command.
My name is Guildenstern, and this is Rosencrantz. I'm sorry, his name's Guildenstern and I'm Rosencrantz.
A pleasure. We've played to bigger, of course, but quality counts for something. I recognize you at once.
And who are we?
As fellow artists.
I thought we were gentlemen.
For some of us, it is performance. For others, patronage. They are two sides of the same coin, or, not to say as there are so many of us, the same side of two coins. Don't clap too loudly. It is a very old world.
What is your line?
Tragedy, sir. Deaths and disclosures, universal and particular. Denouements both unexpected and inexorable, transvestite melodrama on all levels, including the suggestive. We transport you to a world of intrigue and illusion. Clowns, if you like, murderers. We can do you ghosts and battles on the skirmish level. Heroes, villains, tormented lovers, set pieces in the poetic vein. We can do you rapiers, or rape, or both, by all means. Faithless wives and ravished virgins, flagrante delecto at a price, but, well, that comes under realism, for which there are special terms. Getting warm, am I?
Well, I don't know.
Well, it costs little to watch and little more if you happen to get caught up in the action, if that's your taste and, well, times being what they are.
What are they?
Indifferent.
Bad?
Wicked. Now, what precisely is your pleasure? Gentlemen, disport yourselves. There. See anything you like.
What do they do?
Let your imagination run riot. They are beyond surprise.
And how much?
To take part.
To watch.
Watch what?
A private performance.
How private?
Well, there are only two of us. Is that enough?
For an audience, disappointing, but, well, for voyeurs, about average.
And what's the difference?
10 guilders.
10 guilders?
I mean 8.
Together?
Each. I don't think you understand.
What are you saying?
What am I saying? 7?
Where have you been?
Roundabout. A nest of children carries the custom of the town. Juvenile companies, they are the fashion, but they cannot match our repertoire. We'll stoop to anything if that's your bent.
Well, do you like a bet?
What kind of bet did you have in mind?
Double or quits?
Well, heads.
Again. Evens. Heads.
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 Tails.
Again?
No. They don't like the odds.
Right you are. Heads, I win.
No!
Right again! Heads, I win.
No!
Would you believe it? Bet me the year my birth doubled is an odd number.
Your birth?
Well, if you don't trust me, don't bet me.
Would you trust me?
Bet me, then.
My birth?
Odd numbers, you win?
You're odd.
Good. Year of your birth. Double it. Even numbers I win, odd numbers I lose.
We have no money.
Oh. Well then, what have you got? Oh. What's it for this?
It is the best we've got.
Then times are bad indeed. The very air stinks. Oh. Come here, Alfred. Do you lose often, Alfred?
Yes, sir.
And what could you have left to lose?
Nothing, sir.
Do you like being an actor, Alfred?
No, sir.
You and me, we could create a dramatic precedence here. Come, come. That is no way to fill the theatres of Europe. Do you know any plays?
Plays?
Exhibitions.
You said you were actors.
Oh, well, we are. We are. But, well, recently there hasn't been much call.
You lost. Well then, what of the Greeks, perhaps? Are familiar with the tragedy of antiquity, are you? The great homicidal classics? Matri, Patri, Fratri, Sorori, Roxy? Well, it goes without saying.
Saucy.
Suicidal. Maidens aspiring to God's head.
And vice versa.
Your sort of thing, is it?
Well, no. I can't say it is, really. We're more of the blood, love, and rhetoric school.
Well, I'll leave the choice to you. If there's anything to choose between.
Well, they're hardly divisible, sir. Well, I can do you love and blood without the rhetoric. And I can do you rhetoric and blood without the love, and I can do you all three, concurrent or consecutive, but I can't do you love and rhetoric without the blood. Blood is compulsory. They're all blood, you see.
Is that what people want?
It's what we do.
Thank you. We'll let you know.
Thirty-eight!
Position?
Sir?
One of your tableaux?
No, sir.
Oh.
Entrances! There and... Oh, there!
Aren't you going to change it to costume?
I never change out of it, sir.
Always in character.
That's it.
Well, aren't you going to come on?
I am on.
But you are on, then, well, then you can't come on, can
you? I start on.
No, it hasn't started yet. Go on, we'll look out for you.
I'll give you a wave.
Excuse me. Thank you.
Come on.
I said that was lucky.
What? It was tails.
Welcome, dear Rosencrantz and Guildenstern. Moreover, that we did much long to see you, the need we had to use you did provoke our hasty send. Something have you heard of Hamlet's transformation? It should be, more than his father's death, that thus hath put him so much from an understanding of himself I cannot dream of. We entreat you both, that being of so young days brought up with him, that you vouchsafe your rest here in our court some little time, so by your companies to draw him on to pleasures, and to gather so much as from occasion you may glean, whether aught to us unknown afflicts him thus, that open lies within our remedy.
Good gentlemen. He hath much talked of you, and sure I am, two men, there is not living to whom he more adheres. If it may please you to show us so much gentry and goodwill as to expand your time with us a while, for the supply and profit of our hope, your visitation shall receive such thanks as fits a king's remembrance.
Both your majesties might put your dread pleasures more into command than to entreat
him. Well, no, we both obey him. Here, give ourselves in the full bent to lay our service freely at your feet to... Commanding.
Thanks, Rosencrantz and gentle Guildenstern.
Thanks, Guildenstern and gentle Rosencrantz. And I beseech thee instantly to visit my too much changed son.
Well, may our presence and our practices be pleasant and helpful to him.
Aye, amen.
The ambassadors from Norway, my good lord, are joyfully returned.
Thou still hast been the father of good news?
Have I, my lord? I assure you, my good liege, I hold my duty as I hold my soul, both to my God and to my gracious king. And I do think, or else this brain of mine hunts not the the trail of policy, as sure as I used to do, that I have found the very cause of Hamlet's lunacy.
I want to go home.
Don't let them confuse you.
I'm out of my step here.
We'll soon be home and high. No, I'm sorry, dry and home. So, wait, no, I'm,
So no, over my death.
I'll hire you home.
Over my head.
No, I'll dry you high.
It's over my step, over my head. It's over my body to a dead, so heading to a dead
stop. And we'll soon be home and high, and high and dry.
I remember.
Yes?
I remember when there were no questions.
No, there were always questions. To exchange one set for another was no great matter.
Answers, yes. There were answers everywhere you looked.
No, you've forgotten.
I haven't forgotten. How I used to remember my own name and yours. Oh yes, there was no question about it. There was answers everywhere you looked. If I knew who I was, and if people who didn't know who I was, they asked me who I was, and I told them.
Well, you did. Well, look, the trouble is that each of them is plausible without being instinctive. A man standing on the saddle in the heartless, half-alive dawn, banged on the shutters and he called two names. Now, he was just a hat and a cloak, levitating in the great plume of his own breath, but when he called, we came. That much is certain, we came.
You made me look ridiculous in there.
I look just as ridiculous as you did.
Oh, consistency is all I ask.
Give us this day our daily mask.
I want to go home. Which way did we come in? I've lost my sense of direction.
The only beginning is birth and the only end is death. If you can't count on that, what can you count on? Others, I suppose. The opposite. Whatever that is.
Yes, but...
Elephantine?
Not how long, how much?
Retentive. He's a very retentive king. He's a royal retainer.
What are you playing at?
Words. Words. What we have to go on.
Shouldn't we be doing something constructive?
What did you have in mind?
A short, blunt human pyramid? We could go.
Where?
After him.
Why? They've got us placed now. If we start moving about, we'll be chasing each other all night.
How very intriguing. I feel like a spectator. An appalling prospect, given that the only thing that makes it bearable is the irrational belief that somebody interesting will come on in a minute.
See anyone?
No. You?
No. Oh, what a fine persecution. To be intrigued without ever being enlightened. You know, we've had to have practice.
We could play questions.
What would that do?
Practice.
Statement, one love.
Cheating.
Foul.
I haven't started yet.
Statement, two love.
Are you counting that?
What?
Are you counting that?
Foul, no repetition. Three love. First game, two.
I'm not going to play with you if you're going to be like that.
Who served?
Huh?
Foul, no grunts, one love.
Who's go?
Why?
Why not?
What for?
Foul, no synonyms, one all.
What in God's name is going on?
Foul, no rhetoric. 2-1.
What is it all that up to?
Can't you guess?
Were you addressing me?
Is there anyone else?
Who?
How would I know?
Why do you ask?
Are you serious?
Was that rhetoric?
No.
Statement. 2-2. Game point.
What's the matter with you today?
When?
What?
Are you dead?
Am I dead?
Yes or no?
Is there a choice?
Is there a god?
Found one on secretaries. 3-2-1 game all.
What's your name?
What's yours?
I ask first.
Statement, one love.
What's your name when you're at home?
What's yours?
When I'm at home.
Is it different at home?
What home?
Haven't you got one?
Why do you ask?
What are you driving at?
What's your name?
Repetition, two love, match point.
Who do you think you are?
Foul, rhetoric, game and match. Where's it going to end?
That's the question.
It's all questions.
Do you think it matters?
Doesn't it matter to you?
Why should it matter?
What does it matter why?
Doesn't it matter why it matters?
What's the matter with you?
It doesn't matter.
What's the game?
What are the rules? Rosencrantz!
What?
There. How was that?
Clever.
Natural.
Instinctive.
Got it in your head.
I take my hat off to you.
Shake hands.
Now I'll try you.
Not yet. Catch me unawares.
Right. Ready?
Don't be stupid.
Sorry.
Guildenstern!
Doctor!
What?
Consistency is all I ask.
Immortality is all I seek.
He was this day or any week.
Who was that?
Didn't you know him?
He didn't know me.
Well, he didn't see you.
I didn't see him. We shall see.
You know, I hardly knew him.
It's changed. You can see that?
Transformed.
How do you know?
Inside and out.
I see.
He's not himself.
He's changed.
Well, I can see that. Glean what afflicts him.
Me?
Him.
How?
Question and answer. Always are the best.
Right.
You question, I'll answer.
He's afflicted.
I'm him, you see.
And he's you.
What a bit of it.
Are you afflicted?
That's the idea. Are you ready?
Let's go back a bit.
I'm afflicted.
I see.
Glean what afflicts me.
Right.
Question and answer.
How should I begin?
Address me.
My dear Guildenstern.
You've forgotten, haven't you?
My dear Rosencrantz.
I don't think you quite understand. What we are attempting is a hypothesis in which I answer for him while you ask me questions. Right?
Ready.
You know what to do.
What?
Are you stupid?
Did you speak?
Are you deaf?
Pardon?
Not now.
Statement.
Not now! If I had any doubts, or rather hopes, they are dispelled. What could we possibly have in common except our situation? Perhaps we'll come back this way.
Should we go?
Why?
Oh, you mean you pretend to be him and I ask you questions?
Very good.
You had me confused.
No, I could see I had.
How should I begin?
Address me.
Right. My honored lord.
My dear Rosencrantz.
Am I pretending to be you then?
Certainly not. Well, I guess if you like. Shall we continue?
Right.
Question and answer.
My honored lord.
My dear fellow.
How are you?
Afflicted.
Merely in what way?
Transformed.
Inside or out?
Both.
Not much new then.
No, go into detail. Dell. Probe the background. Establish the situation.
So your uncle's the king of Denmark?
And my father before him.
His father before him?
No, my father before him.
But surely.
You might well ask.
Let me get it straight. Your father was king, you were his only son. Your father dies, you're of age, but your uncle becomes king.
Yes.
Unorthodox.
Undid me.
Undeniably. Where were you?
In Germany.
Usurpation then?
He slipped in.
Which reminds me.
Well, it would.
I don't want to be personal.
It's common knowledge.
Your mother's marriage.
He slipped in.
His body's still warm.
So was hers.
Extraordinary.
Indecent.
Tasty.
Suspicious.
It makes you think.
Don't think I even thought of it.
And with her husband's brother.
Well, they were close.
She went to him.
Too close.
For comfort.
It looks bad.
It adds up.
Incest to adultery.
Would you go so far?
Never.
To sum up, your father, whom you love, dies. You're his heir. You come back to find that hardly was the corpse cold before his young brother popped onto his throne and into his sheets, thereby offending both legal and natural practice. Now, why are you behaving in this extraordinary manner?
I can't imagine. But that was all well known. Common property, and yet he sent for us. And we did come.
I say, I heard music.
Well, we're here.
Like a band. I thought I heard a band.
Rosencrantz.
What?
Guildenstern.
What?
Don't you discriminate at all.
What?
Go and see if he's there.
Who?
There.
Yes.
What's he doing?
Walking.
To himself? Is he alone?
No.
Well, then he's not walking by himself, is he?
Not by himself. Coming this way. I think we should go.
Why? They've got us marked now.
For yourself, sir, I shall go as old as I am. But a crab, you could go backwards.
Though this be madness, yet there is method in it.
Will you walk out the air, my lord? Into my grave?
Indeed, that is out the air.
My lord, I will take my leave of you. You cannot, sir, take from me anything that I will more willingly part withal. Except my life. Accept my life. Accept my life.
Well be with you, my lord. You go to seek Hamlet? There he is.
God save you, sir.
My lord.
My most dear lord.
My excellent good friends. At us the Guildenstern. Rosencrantz. Good lads. Adieu, you both. The natural philosophy could make it out.
Oh, there are the players.
Gentlemen, you're welcome to Elsinore, your hands. Come then, you're welcome. But my uncle, father, and aunt, mother are deceived.
Well, then what, my dear lord?
I'm the mad north northwest when the wind is southerly. I know not from an end, so. Buzz, buzz.
Yes?
I thought you... What?
No.
Well, you know, I think we can say we made some headway.
You think so?
I think we can say that.
I think he made us look ridiculous.
We played it close to the chest, of course.
Question and answer. Old ways are the best ways. He was scoring us off us all down the line.
No, look, he might have caught us on the wrong foot once or twice, perhaps, but I thought we gained some ground.
He murdered us.
He might have had the edge.
27-3, and you think of a hat, he might have had the edge. Right. He murdered us.
But what about our evasions?
Our evasions were lovely. Were you sent for?
Oh, yes, we were sent for, my lord. I didn't know where to put myself. Well, no, he had 6 rhetoricals.
It was question and answer, all right. 27 questions he got out in 10 minutes and answered 3. I was waiting for you to delve. When is he going to start delving, I asked myself.
And 2 repetitions.
Not a leading question between us.
Well, we got his symptoms, didn't we?
Half of what he said meant something else, and the other half meant nothing at all.
Thwarted ambition, a sense of grievance, that's my diagnosis.
6 rhetorical and 2 repetition, leaving 19, of which we answered 15. And what did we get in return? He's depressed. Denmark's a prison, and he'd rather live in a nutshell. Some shadow play about the nature of ambition, which never got down to cases. And finally, one direct question, which might have led somewhere, but led in fact to his illuminating claim to tell a hawk from a handsaw.
No, when the wind is southerly.
And the weather's clear.
And when it isn't, he can't.
He's at the mercy of the elements. Is that southerly?
It doesn't look southerly. What made you think so?
I didn't say I think so. It could be northerly for all I know.
No, I wouldn't have thought so.
You're going to be dogmatic.
Hold on. But we came from roughly south, according to a rough map.
So which way did we come in then, roughly?
Well, if it is morning, then the sun will be easterly. Then we can assume that.
That it's morning.
Well, if it is, and the sun's over there, well, then that would be northerly. However, if it is not, and the sun is in fact over there, then... No, wait, no, that would still be northerly. To put it another way, if we came from up there, and it is morning, the sun should be over there, and if it's in fact over there, well, they must have come from down there. However, if that is suddenly, and the sun is really over there, well, then it's the afternoon. However, if none of these is the case...
Why don't you go and have a look?
Pragmatism. Is that all you have to offer? You clearly have no conception of where we stand. You won't find the answer written down for you in the bowl of a compass, I can tell you that. Besides, it's too far north to tell. It's probably dark out there.
I merely suggest that the position of the sun, if it is out, would give a rough idea of the time. Alternatively, the clock, if it is going, would give a rough idea of the position of the sun. I forget which you're trying to establish.
I'm trying to establish the direction of the wind.
There isn't any wind. A draft? Yes.
Well, in that case, the origin. If we trace it to its source, it might give us a rough idea of where we came in, which might give us a rough idea of south for further reference.
It's coming up through the floor. That can't be south, can it?
No, that's not a direction. Lick your toe, wave it about a bit.
I think you're going to have to lick it for me.
I'm willing to let the whole matter drop.
I could lick yours, of course.
No, thank you.
I'll even wave it around for you.
What in God's name is the matter with you?
I'm just being friendly.
Somebody might come in. That's what we're countering, after all. Ultimately.
Perhaps they've all trampled each other to death in the rush. Give them a shout. Something provocative. Intrigue them.
No, wheels have been set in motion and they have their own pace to which we are condemned. If we start being arbitrary, it'll be a shambles. Well, at least let us hope so. For if we happen, just happen to discover or even suspect that our spontaneity was part of their order. Oh, I would know we were lost.
You know, a Chinaman of the Tang Dynasty, and, you know, by definition a philosopher. One night dreamed he was a butterfly, and from then on could never quite be sure he wasn't a butterfly dreaming himself a Chinese philosopher. Envy him in his twofold security.
Fire!
What?
Sorry. I'm merely demonstrating the misuse of free speech to prove that it exists. Not a move. They should burn to death in their shoes.
Follow him, friends. We'll play tomorrow. Can you hear me, old friend? Can you play the murder of Gonzago?
Aye, my lord.
You could, for a need, study a speech of some dozen or 16 lines which I'd set down and serve it, could you not?
Aye, my lord.
Very well. Follow that lord, and look you, mock him not. My good friends, I'll leave you till night. You're welcome to Elsinore.
Good, my lord.
So you've caught up?
Not yet, sir.
So you've caught on?
Not yet! You left us.
No, I'd forgotten. You performed a dramatic spectacle on the way. I'm sorry we had to miss it.
We can't look each other in the face! You don't understand the humiliation of it. To be denied of the single assumption which makes our existence viable, that somebody is watching. The plot was two corpses gone before they caught sight of themselves, stripped naked in the middle of nowhere and pouring themselves down a bottomless well.
Ooh, is that 38?
There we were, demented children mincing about in clothes that no one ever wore, speaking as no man ever spoke, swearing love in wigs and rhymed couplets, killing each other with wooden swords, hollow protestations of faith hurled after empty promises of vengeance. And every gesture, every pose vanishing into the thin, unpopulated air. We ransomed our dignity to the clouds, and the uncomprehending birds listened. Don't you see? We're actors. We're the opposites of people. Think. In your heads now, think of the most private, secret, intimate thing you have ever done, secure in the knowledge of its privacy. Are you thinking of it? Well, I saw you do it.
You never, it's a lie.
We're actors. We pledged our identity secure in the conventions of our trade that somebody would be watching, and then gradually no one was. We were caught high and dry. It was not until the murderer's long soliloquy that we were able to look around frozen as we were in profile. Our eyes searched you out first confidently, then hesitantly, then desperately, as each patch of turf, each log, every exposed corner in every direction proved uninhabited. And all the while, the murderous king addressed the horizon with his dreary, interminable guilt. Our heads began to move, wary as lizards. The corpse of unsullied Rosalinda peeped through his fingers, and the king faltered. Even then, habit and a stubborn trust that our audience spied upon us from behind the nearest bush forced our bodies to blunder on long after they had emptied of any meaning, until like runaway carts they dragged to a halt. No one came forward. No one shouted at us. The silence was unbreakable. It imposed itself upon us. It was obscene. We took off our crowns and swords and cloth of gold and moved silent on the road to Elsinore.
Bravo! Bravo! Brilliantly recreation! These eyes could wish. A rather stronger metaphor, mind you. No, it's not a criticism. That's just a matter of taste. And so, here you are, with a vengeance. That's a figure of speech, isn't it? Well, let us say we made up for it, for you can have no doubt of him to thank for your appearance at the court tonight.
We are counting on you to take him out of himself. You are the pleasures which we draw him onto. And by that, I don't mean your usual filth.
No.
You can't treat royalty like that, with like people with normal perverted desires. They know nothing of that, and you know nothing of them, to your mutual survival. So, you know, give him a good, clean show, suitable for all the family. Or you can be rest assured we play in the tavern tonight.
Or the night after.
Or not.
We already have an entrance here, and always have had.
You've played for him before?
Yes, sir.
And what is his bent?
Classical.
Saucy.
What were you playing?
The Murder of Gonzago. Oh,
full of fine cadence and corsets.
Pirated from the Italian.
What's it about?
It's about a king and queen.
Escapism, what else?
Blood.
Love and rhetoric.
Yes.
Where are you going?
I can come and go as I please.
You're evidently someone who knows their way around.
I've been here before.
We're still finding our feet.
I should concentrate on not losing your heads.
Do you speak from knowledge?
Precedent.
You've been here before.
And I know which way the wind is blowing.
Oh, operating on two levels now, are we? How clever. I assume it comes naturally to you, being in the business, so to speak. No, the truth is, we value your company. For lack of any other, we've been left so much to our own devices that after a while, one welcomes the uncertainty of being left to someone else's.
Uncertainty is the normal state. You're nobody special.
No, but for God's sake, what are we supposed to do?
Relax! Respond, that's what people do. You can't go through life questioning your situation at every turn.
No, but we don't know what's going on or what to do with ourselves. We don't know how to act.
Act natural. You know why you're here, at least.
We only know what we're told, and that's little enough. And for all we know, it isn't even true.
For all anyone knows, nothing is. Everything has to be taken on trust. Truth is only that which is taken to be true. It's the currency of living. There may be nothing behind it, but it doesn't matter so long as it is honored. One acts on assumptions. What do you assume?
Hamlet is not himself, outside or in. We have to glean what afflicts him.
Well, he doesn't give much away.
Who does nowadays?
He's melancholy.
Melancholy?
Mad.
How is he mad?
Ah. How is he mad?
Well, more morose than mad, perhaps.
Melancholy.
Moody.
He has moods.
Of moroseness?
No, madness. And yet...
Quite.
For instance...
He talks to himself, which might be madness.
If he didn't talk sense, which he does.
Which suggests the opposite.
Of what?
Oh, no, I think I have it. A man talking sense to himself is no madder than a man talking nonsense not to himself.
Or just as mad.
Or just as mad.
And he does both.
So there you have it.
Stark raving sane.
Why?
Ah.
Exactly.
Exactly what?
Exactly why.
Exactly why what?
Why what exactly?
Why? Why is he mad?
I don't know.
The old man thinks he's in love with his daughter.
Oh, good God, we're out of our depth here.
Oh, no! No, he hasn't got a daughter. The old man thinks he's in love with his daughter?
The old man is...
No, Hamlet, in love with the old man's daughter, the old man thinks.
It's beginning to make sense. Unrequited passion.
Wait. Nobody leave this room! What? Well, without a very good reason.
Why not?
All the strolling about is going too arbitrary by heart. I'm rapidly losing my grip. From now on, reason will prevail.
I have lines to learn.
Pass.
Next.
What did you expect?
Something. Someone. Yeah, nothing.
One might well accost him. Yes, this definitely looks like a chance to me. A direct, informal approach. Man to man, straight from the shoulder, now look here, what's it all about sort of thing. Yes? Yes. This definitely looks like a chance to me. It definitely looks like one to be grabbed with both hands. No point in looking at the white, a gift horse without looking at the whites of his eyes, etc. We're overawed. That's our trouble. When it comes to the point we succumb to their personality.
Nymphenia license. Be all my sins remembered.
It's like a public park.
Very impressive. Yes, I thought your direct, informal approach was going to kill this thing dead in its tracks. If I might make a suggestion, sit down and shut up. Stop being perverse.
I'm not going to stand for it. Guess who?
Alfred?
Excuse me.
I beg your pardon.
What did he do?
I put my foot down.
My hand was on the floor. You put your hand under her foot. What for?
I thought...
Don't leave me.
Right, we haven't got much time.
Wait, what are you doing?
Dress rehearsal now. If you two wouldn't mind just moving back. Good. Everyone ready? And for goodness sake, remember what we're doing. We always use the same costumes, more or less, so they forget what they're supposed to be in, you see. Stop picking your nose, Alfred! When queens have to do it, they do it by a cerebral process passed down in the blood. Good, now, silence. And off we go.
Full 30 times has Phoebus...
No, no, no! Don't show first, your confounded majesty! They're a bit out of practice, but they always pick up wonderfully for the desk. It brings out a nice poetry in them.
Oh, nice.
There's nothing more unconvincing than an unconvincing death. Act one moves now.
What is the dumb show for?
Well, it's a device, really. It makes the action that follows more or less comprehensible. You understand? We are tied down to a language which makes up in obscurity, but it lacks in style.
Who was that?
The king's brother and uncle to the prince.
Not exactly fraternal.
Not exactly avuncular as time goes on. Gentlemen, it doesn't seem to be coming. We're not getting it at all. What did you think?
What was I supposed to think?
You're not getting across. It was a mess.
It's going to be chaos on the night.
Yeah, spectators.
Act two. Positions. Lucianus, nephew to the king, usurped by his uncle and shattered by his mother's incestuous marriage, loses his reason, throwing the court into turmoil as he alternates between bitter melancholy and unrestricted lunacy, staggering from the suicidal to the homicidal. He at last confronts his mother and in the scene of provocative ambiguity begs her to repent and recant. The king, tormented by guilt, haunted by fear, decides to dispatch his nephew to England and entrusts this undertaking to two smiling accomplices, friends, courtiers, to two spies. Giving them a letter to present before the English court. And so they depart on board ship. And they arrive and disembark and present themselves before the English king. The English king. But where is the prince? Where indeed the plot has thickened, a twist of fate and cunning has put into their hands a letter that seals their debts. Traitors hoist by their own petard or victims of the gods, we shall never know.
Well, if it isn't... Oh, wait a minute. Oh, it's taking me back to... When was it? Oh, I know you, don't I? I never forget a face. Not that I remember yours, that is. For a moment I thought... Nah, I don't know you, do I? Yes, you're quite wrong. You must have mistaken me for someone else.
Are you familiar with this play?
No.
A slaughterhouse. 8 corpses all told. It brings out the best in us.
You? What do you know about death?
It's what the actors do best. They have to exploit whatever talent is given to them, and their talent is dying. They can die heroically,
comically, ironically, slowly, suddenly, disgustingly, charmingly, or from a great height. My own talent is more general. I extract significance from melodrama, a significance which it does not, in fact, contain. But occasionally, from out of this matter, there escapes a thin beam of light that, when seen from the right angle, can crack the shell of mortality.
Is that all they can do then? Die?
Oh, no, no, they killed beautifully. In fact, some of them kill even better than they die. The rest die better than they kill. They're a team.
Which ones are which?
There's not much in it.
Actors. No, the cheap mechanics of melodrama, that isn't death. You choke and you scream, you fall to your knees, but that doesn't bring death home to anybody, it doesn't. Well, it doesn't catch them unawares and start the whisper in their skull which says, one day you are going to die. Come on, you die so many times, how can you expect anybody to believe in your death?
On the contrary, it's the only kind they do believe in, they're conditioned to it. I had an actor once who was condemned to hang for stealing a sheep, or a lamb, I forget which, so I got permission to have him hanged in the middle of a play. Had to change the plot around a bit, but I thought it would be effective, you know, and you wouldn't believe it, but he just wasn't convincing. It was impossible to suspend one's own disbelief, and what with the audience jeering and throwing peanuts, why, the whole thing was a disaster. He did nothing but stand there and cry all the time, right out of character. Just stood there and cried. Never again. Audiences know what to expect, and that is all they are prepared to believe in. Show!
No. No. No, you know, you've got it all wrong. You can't act death. The fact of it is nothing to do with seeing it. It's not gasps of blood and falling about it. You know, it's just a man failing to reappear. Now you see him, now you don't. That's all that's real. Here one minute and gone the next and never coming back. An exit, unobtrusive and unannounced. A disappearance, gathering weight until... well, until finally it is heavy with death.
That must be East, then. I think we can assume that.
I'm assuming nothing.
No, it's all right. That's the sun, East.
Where?
I watched it come up.
No. Wait, no, it was light all the time. You just opened your eyes very, very slowly.
You're a massive prejudice.
I've been taken in before.
Rings a bell.
They're waiting to see what we're going to do.
Good old East.
As soon as we make a move, they'll come pouring in from every side, shouting obscure obstructions, confusing us with ridiculous remarks, messing us about from here to Easter and getting our names wrong.
Oh, Guildenstern!
You're wanted.
Friends both, shall join you with some further aid. Hamlet in madness hath Polonius slain, and from his mother's closet hath he dragged him. Go seek him out, speak fair, and bring the body into the chapel. Gertrude, we'll call up our wisest friends and let them know both what we mean to do and what...
Well,
quite.
Well, well.
Quite. Seek him out, etc.
Quite.
Well. Well, that's a step in the right direction.
You didn't like him.
Who?
Good God, I hope more tears are shed for us.
Well, it's progress, isn't it? Something positive. Seek him out. But where does one begin?
Well, that's a step in the right direction.
I'll go this way, you go that way.
All right.
Wait. I'll go that way, you go this way.
Okay.
Stop. Just stop. We should stick together, it might be violent.
That's a good point. I'll come with you.
No, I'll come with you.
All right.
I'll come with you my way.
All right.
Stop. You might come here. That'd be stupid, wouldn't it?
That's a good point. Well, I'll stay and you go.
Cool. Stop. We should stick together, it might be violent.
Good point. Well, at last we are getting somewhere. You know, he might not come.
Oh, he'll come.
We'd have some explaining to do.
Oh, he'll come. You can take my word for it. He's coming.
What's he doing?
Walking.
By himself?
No.
Who's he with?
The old man.
Walking?
No.
Not walking?
No.
Ah. Well, that's an opening I've ever did see one. Let him walk into a trap.
What trap?
Stand there, don't let him pass.
close.
There's a limit to what two people can do.
He was dead.
Of course he's dead.
Like, properly.
Well,
death, isn't it? Perhaps he'll come back this way.
But no. If you can't learn from experience, what else have you got?
We could give him a shout.
I thought we'd been into all that.
Hamlet! Lord Hamlet! My lord, you must tell us where the body is, so that we may take it thence and bear it to the chapel. Where is the dead body?
Companion with dust, but it is kin.
Tell us where it is, so we may take it thence and bear it to the chapel.
Do not believe it.
Believe what?
That I can keep your counsel, not mine own. Besides, to be demanded of a sponge, what application may be made by the son of a king?
Take you me for a sponge, my lord?
Aye, sir. One who soaks up the king's countenances, his rewards, his authorities. But such officers do the king best service in the end. He keeps them like an apple in the corner of his jaw, swallowed. And you need what you have gleaned, it is but squeezing you. And sponge, you shall be dry again.
I understand you not, my lord.
I'm glad of it. A knavish speech sleeps in a foolish ear.
Tell us where the body is so we may take it to the king.
The body is with the king, but the king is not with the body. The king is a thing.
A thing, my lord?
Of nothing. Bring me to him.
And yet, it does not seem enough to have breathed such significance. Was that all? And why us? Anybody would have done it. And in the end, we have contributed nothing.
It was a trying episode while it lasted. But they've done with us now.
Done what?
I don't pretend to have understood, and quite frankly, I'm not very interested. If they won't tell us, that's their affair. For my part, I'm just glad that that's the last we've seen of them.
I knew it wasn't over.
Oh, what now?
We're taking Hamlet to England. Is he there?
Yes.
What's he doing?
Talking.
To himself? Well, is he alone?
No, he's with a soldier.
And he's not talking to himself, is he?
Not by himself. Should we go?
Where?
Anywhere.
Why?
There it is again. All I ask is for a change of ground.
He must be staying our daily round.
Have us hanging about till we're dead, at least. The spring can't last forever. We'll be cold soon.
Good sir, whose powers are these?
They are of Norway, sir.
And purpose, sir, I pray you?
Against some part of Poland.
Who commands them, sir?
The nephew to old Norway, Fortinbras.
We'll be cold. The summer can't last forever.
Well, it's autumnal.
No leaves.
Autumnal. It's nothing to do with the leaves. It has to do with a certain brownness around the edges of the day. No, brown is creeping up on us. Take my word for it. Russets and tangerine shades of old gold are flushing the very outside edges of the senses. Deep shining ochres, burnt umbers, and baked parchments of earth reflecting on itself and through itself, filtering the light. At this time, perhaps, coincidentally, the leaves might fall, somewhere, by repute. Oh, yesterday was blue like smoke.
I got it again, then.
Humbly thank you, sir.
Goodbye, sir.
Will it please you go, my lord?
I'll follow you straight. Go a little before.
Is he there?
Yes.
What's he doing?
Talking.
To himself?
Yes. He said we can go.
Promise. I'd like to know where I am. I mean, even if I don't know where I am, I'd like to know that. If we go, there's no knowing.
No knowing what?
If we'll ever come back.
But we don't want to come back.
Well, that may very well be true, but do we want to go?
We'll be free.
I don't know. It's the same sky.
We've come this far. And besides, anything could happen yet.
Are you there?
Where?
Oh, flying start.
Is that you?
Yes.
How do you know?
Oh, for God's sake.
So we're not done then?
Well, we're here, aren't we?
Are we? I can't see a thing.
Well, you can still think, can't you?
Think so. You can still talk? What should I say?
Don't bother. Well, you can still feel, can't you?
Ah, there's life in me yet.
Wait, what are you feeling?
a leg. Yes, it feels at my leg.
How does it feel?
Dead.
Dead?
I can't feel a thing.
I'll give it a pinch.
Ah, sorry.
Well, that's cleared that up. We must have gone north, of course.
Of course.
Land in the midnight sun, that is.
Of course. I think it's getting light.
Not for night.
This far north.
And that's what, of course.
Of course. Yes. It's lighter than it was. It'll be night soon this far north.
I suppose we should go to sleep. Tired?
No. I don't think I'd take to it. Sleep all night, can't see a thing all day. Those Eskimos must have a quiet life.
I thought... What? I thought you... Oh, I've lost all capacity for disbelief. You know, I'm not sure I can even rise to a little gentle skepticism.
Should we stretch our legs?
No, I don't feel like stretching my legs.
I can stretch them for you if you like.
No.
We can stretch each other's, so that way we don't have to go anywhere.
Oh, somebody might come in.
In where?
Out here.
In out here.
On deck.
Nice bit of planking, that.
Yes. I'm rather fond of boats myself. I like how they're contained. You don't have to worry about where to go or whether to go at all. The question doesn't arise because, well, you're on a boat, aren't you? Boats are safe areas in the game of tag. The players will hold their position until the music starts. Yes. Yeah, I think I'll spend most of my life on boats.
Very healthy.
One is free on a boat.
Well, for a time. I mean, relatively.
What's it like?
It's rough. I think I'm going to be sick.
Other side, I think.
Free to move, speak, extemporize, and yet we have not been cut loose. Our truancy is defined by one fixed star, and our drift represents merely a slight change of angle to it. We may seize the moment, toss it about as the moments pass, a short dash here, an exploration there, but, well, we are always brought round in full circle to face the single immutable fact that we, Rosencrantz and Guildenstern, bearing a letter from one king to another, are taking Hamlet to England.
He's there.
What's he doing?
Sleeping.
It's all right for him.
What is?
He can sleep.
It's all right for him.
It's all done for him.
He's got us.
He's got us now.
And we've got nothing.
All they ask is our common due.
For those in peril and sea.
Give us this day our daily cue.
What now?
What do you mean?
Well, nothing's happening.
Well, we're on a boat.
I'm well aware of that.
Then what did you expect? Oh, we act on scraps of information, sifting half-remembered directives we can hardly separate from instinct. Had money in both hands?
Yes.
Every time?
Yes.
What's the point of that?
I wanted to make you happy.
How much did he give you?
Who?
The king. He gave us some money.
How much did he give you?
I asked first.
I got the same as you.
He wouldn't discriminate between us.
How much did you get?
The same.
How do you know?
Well, you just told him. How do you know?
He wouldn't discriminate between us.
Even if he could.
Which he never could.
He couldn't even be sure of mixing us up.
Without mixing us up.
Oh, why don't you say anything original? No wonder the whole thing is so stagnant. You never take me up in anything.
I can't think of anything original. I'm only good in support.
I'm sick of making the running.
It must be your dominant personality. What's going to become of us?
No, they're there. Yeah, we'll be all right, don't worry. There, I'll make sure we're okay. Okay.
But we've got nothing to go on. We're on our own.
We're on a boat going to England. We're taking Hamlet there.
What for?
What for? Where have you been?
When?
We won't know what to do when we get there.
Well, we take him to the king.
Will he be there?
No, the king of England.
He's expecting us.
No.
You won't know what we're playing at. What do we say?
Well, we've got a letter. You remember the letter.
Do I?
Everything is explained in the letter. We count on that.
Is that it then?
What?
We take Hamlet to the English king, and then we hand over the letter. What then?
Well, there may be something in the letter to keep us going a bit.
And if not?
Well, that's it. We're done.
That's a loose end.
Yep.
Are there likely to be loose ends? Who is the English king anyway?
Well, that depends on when we get there.
What do you think it says?
Oh, you know, greetings, expressions of loyalty, calling in of favours, asking of debts, obscure promises balanced by vague threats, you know, diplomacy, regards to the family.
And about Hamlet.
Oh, yes.
And us, the full background.
I should say so.
So we've got a letter which explains everything.
You've got it. What's the matter?
The letter.
Have you got it?
Have I? Where would I put it?
You can't have lost it.
I must have.
That's odd. I thought the king gave it to me.
Perhaps he did.
But you seem so sure that you haven't got it.
It was me who hadn't got it.
No, but if the king never gave it to you, there's no reason why you should have had it in the first place, in which case, I don't see all the fuss about you not having it.
I admit it's confusing.
Oh, this is all getting rather undisciplined. The boat, the night, the sense of isolation and uncertainty. All of these induce a loosening of the concentration. We must not lose control. Tighten up. Now. Either you have lost the letter, or you never had it to lose in the first place, in which case, the king never gave it to you. In which case, the king must have given it to me, in which case, I would have put it into my right pocket. In which case, it'll be... here. We mustn't drop off again like that.
Now that we've found it, why were we looking for it?
We thought it was lost.
Something else.
No?
Now we've lost attention.
What tension?
What was the last thing I said before we dropped off?
Well, let's see. When was that?
I can't remember.
Oh, what a shambles! No wonder the whole thing is... no wonder we're not getting anywhere.
Not even England. I don't believe in it anyway.
Just a conspiracy of cartographers, then?
I mean, I don't believe it. I tried to picture us arriving. A little harbour, perhaps. Roads, inhabitants to point the way, horses on the roads, riding for a day or a fortnight, and then the palace and the English king. That would be the logical kind of thing, but my mind remains a blank. No, we're slipping off the map.
Yes, yes. But you don't remember anything till it's happened, and it has happened, hasn't it?
We drift down time clutching at straws, but what good's a brick to a drowning man?
Well, don't give up. We can't be long now.
Might as well be dead. Do you think death could be a boat?
No. No, no, death is... not. Death isn't. You take my meaning. Death is the ultimate negative. I mean, you can't not be on a boat.
I've frequently not been on boats.
No, what you've been is not on boats.
I wish I was dead. I could jump over the side, that'll put a spoke in the wheel.
Unless they're counting on it.
I shall remain on board, that'll put a spoke in the wheel.
All right. We don't question, we don't doubt, we perform. But a line must be drawn somewhere, and I'd like to put it on record that I have no confidence in England, thank you. And even if it is true, it'd be another shambles.
I don't see why.
He won't know what we're talking about. What are we going to say?
We say,
Your Majesty, we have arrived.
And who are you?
We are Rosencrantz and Guildenstern.
Never heard of you.
Well, we're nothing special.
What's your game?
We've got our instructions.
First I've heard of it.
Well, let me finish. We've come from Denmark.
What do you want?
Nothing. Oh, we're delivering Hamlet.
Who's he?
No, well, you've heard of him.
Oh, I've heard of him, and I want nothing to do with it.
No, but...
You march in here without but so much as a by your leave and expect me to take every lunatic you try to pass over the lot of unsubstantiated...
You've got a letter.
I see. Well, this seems to support your story, such as it is. It is an exact command from the King of Denmark for several different reasons, importing Denmark's health and England's too, that on the reading of this letter, without delay, I should have Hamlet's head cut off. Sun's going down. It'll be dark soon.
Do you think so?
I was just making conversation. He's our friend.
How do you know?
From our young days brought up with him.
You've only got their word for it.
But that's what we depend on.
Well, yes. No, and then again, no! Let us keep things in perspective. Assume, if you like, that they're going to kill him. Well, he is a man, he is mortal, death comes to us all, etc., and therefore he was going to die anyway. Also, look at it from the social point of view. He's just one man. His death would be well within reason and convenience. And then again, what is so terrible about death? As Socrates so philosophically put it, since we don't know what death is, it is illogical to fear it. Yeah, it might be very nice. Certainly it is a release from the burden of life, and for the godly a haven of reward. Or to look at it from another point of view, we're little men, we don't know the ins and outs of the matter. There are wheels within wheels, etc. It would be presumptuous of us to intervene with the design of fate, or even of kings. All in all, I think we'd be well advised to leave well alone. Tie up the letter, neatly, like that. You know, they won't notice the broken seal, assuming you were in character.
But what's the point?
Don't apply logic.
He's done nothing to us.
Or justice.
It's awful.
But it could have been worse. I was beginning to think it was.
Position as I see it then, we Rosencrantz and Guildenstern, from our young days brought up with him, are awakened by a man standing on his saddle, and are summoned and arrive, and are instructed to glean what afflicts him, and draw him on to pleasures, such as a play, which unfortunately is cancelled and abandoned, in some confusion owing to certain nuances outside our appreciation, which, among other causes, results in, among other effects, a high, not to say homicidal excitement in Hamlet, whom we, in consequence, are escorting for his own good to England. Good. We're on top of it now. I'm assuming nothing. The position as I see it then, that's west, unless we're off course, in which case it's night. The king gave you the same as me, the king gave me the same as you. The king gave you the letter, but the king never gave me the letter. We don't know what's in the letter. We take Hamlet to the English king, depending on when we get there, who he is, and we hand over the letter, which may or may not have something in it to keep us going for a bit. And if not, we're done, at a loose end. We could have done worse. I don't think we missed any chances. Not that we're getting any help. If we stopped breathing, we'd vanish.
Here we go.
Yes, but what?
Out of the void, finally, a sound. Well, on a boat, admittedly. Outside of the action, admittedly. The perfect silence of the wet, lazy slap of water on water and the creaking of timber breaks, giving rise at once to the speculation or the assumption or the hope that something is about to happen. A piper's cut. A sailor has pursed his lips against a woodwind, his fingers and thumbs governing, let us say, the vintages, whereupon, giving a breath, let us say, it, the pipe, discourses as the saying goes. Most eloquent music. A thing like that, it could change the course of events. Go and see what it is.
Someone playing on a pipe.
Or go and find him.
What then?
I don't know, request the tune.
What good would that do?
Wait, what is the momentum?
Why, is something happening? You quite escaped my attention. Thought I heard a band. Plausibility's all, I presume.
Of course, this day I'd only tune.
Aha! All in the same boat, then. Everybody out! Where are we?
Travelling.
Of course, we haven't got there yet.
Are we all right for England?
You look all right to me. I don't think you're very particular in England. Alfred!
What are you doing here?
Travelling. Right, blend into the background. Pleased to see us.
You've come out of it very well so far.
And you?
In disfavor. Our play offended the king.
Yes.
Well, he's a second husband himself. Tactless, really.
It was quite a good play, nevertheless.
We never really got going. It was getting quite interesting when they stopped it. That's the way to travel.
What were you doing back there?
Hiding. We had to run for it just as we were.
Stowaways.
Naturally. We didn't get paid owing to circumstances ever so slightly beyond our control, and all the money we ever had, we lost betting on certainties. Life is a gamble at terrible odds. If it was a bet, you wouldn't take it. Did you know that any number doubled is even?
Is it?
We learn something every day to our cost. But we troopers just go on and on. Do you know what happens to old actors?
What?
Nothing. They're still acting. Surprised then?
What?
Surprised to see us.
Well, we knew it wasn't the end.
With practically everyone on his feet. What do you make of it so far?
We haven't got much to go on.
You speak to him?
It's possible.
It wouldn't make any difference.
But it's possible.
Pointless.
It's allowed.
Allowed, yes. Oh, we're not restricted. No boundaries have been set, no inhibitions imposed. We have, for the while, secured, or blundered into, our release, for the while. Spontaneity and whim are the order of the day. Wheels are turning, but they're not our concern. We can breathe. We can relax. We can do what we like and say what we like to whomever we like. Without restriction.
Within limits, of course.
Oh, well, certainly within limits.
Compulsion towards philosophical introspection is his chief characteristic. It does not mean he's mad. It does not mean that he isn't. Very often it doesn't mean anything at all, which may or may not be a kind of madness.
Well, it really boils down to symptoms. Pregnant replies, mystic illusions, mistaken identities, arguing his father as his mother, that sort of thing. Intimations of suicide, foregoing of exercise, loss of nerve, hints of claustrophobia, not to say delusions of imprisonment, invocations of camels, chameleons, capones, whales, weasels, hawks, and handsaws. Riddles, quibbles, and evasions, stabbing his elders, abusing his parents, insulting his lover, and appearing hatless in public, droop-stalking, knock-kneed, and sighing like a lovesick schoolboy, like, at his age, is coming on rather strong.
And talking to himself.
And talking to himself. Well, where has that got us?
She's the player.
Her player offended the king.
Offended the king.
Who orders her arrest.
Orders her arrest.
So she escapes on the boat to England.
To which she meets.
Guildenstern and Rosencrantz, taking Hamlet.
Who also offended the king.
And killed Polonius.
Offended the king in a variety of ways.
To England. That seems to be it.
Incidents. All we get is incidents. Dear God, is it too much to ask for a little sustained action? Doubled is an odd number.
No!
Your birth.
Oh, we've travelled too far. Our momentum has taken over. We move idly towards eternity without possibility of reprieve or hope of explanation.
Be happy. If you're not even happy, what's so good about surviving? We'll be alright. Suppose we just go on.
Go where?
To England.
England? That's a dead end. I never believed in it anyway.
All we've got to do is make a report, and that'll be that, surely.
No, I don't believe it. a shore, a harbour, say, and we step off and we stop somewhere and say, where's the king? And they say, oh, you just take the first left up there. No, I don't believe any of it.
It doesn't sound very plausible.
And even if we came face to face, what would we say?
We say,
we've arrived.
And who are you?
Guildenstern and Rosencrantz.
Which is which?
Well, I'm... you're...
What's this all about?
Well, we were bringing Hamlet, but then some pirates...
I don't begin to understand. Who are all these people and what's it got to do with me? You come marching in here with some cock and bull story.
We have a letter.
A letter? Well, yes, that's true. A letter, that is something. As England is Denmark's faithful tributary, as lock between them like the palm might flourish, etc. That on the knowing of these contents, without delay of any kind, should those bearers, Rosencrantz and Guildenstern, put to sudden death...
They've gone. It's all over.
Where we went wrong was getting on a boat. We can move, of course, rattle about, change direction, but our movement is contained within a larger one which carries us along as inexorably as the wind and current.
They had it in for us, didn't they? Right from the beginning. Who'd have thought we were so important?
Why us? Who are we that so much to converge on our little death? Who are we?
You are Rosencrantz and Guildenstern. That's enough.
No, it is not enough to be told so little to such an end and still finally to be denied an explanation.
In our experience, most things end in death.
Your experience? Actors. I'm talking about death. And you've never experienced that. And you cannot act it. You die 1,000 casual deaths when none of that intensity squeezes out life. And no blood runs cold in you, because even as you die, you know you'll come back in a different hat. But no one gets up after death. There is no applause. There is only silence and some secondhand clothes and that... Oh, death! If we have a destiny, then so has she. And if this is ours, then let that be hers. If there are no explanations for us, then let there be none for her.
Oh, come, gentlemen, no flattery, t'was merely competent. Well, what did you think? You see, it is what's expected. For a moment you thought I'd cheated.
Oh, very good. Very good. Took me in completely. Didn't it take you in completely? Encore.
So there's an end to that. It's commonplace. Light goes with life, and in the winter of your years, the dark comes early.
No, not for us, not like that. Dying is not romantic. Death is not a game which will soon be over. Death is not. Death isn't. It's the absence of presence, nothing more. The endless time of never coming back, a gap you can't see, and when the wind blows through it, it makes no sound.
That's it then, is it? Sun's going down or the earth's coming up? That's the fashionable theory, has it? Not that it makes any difference. What was it all about? When did it all begin? Couldn't we just stay put? I mean, no one was going to come on and drag us off. We'll just have to wait. We're still young, fit. We've got years. We did nothing wrong. Did we?
I can't remember.
All right, then. I don't care. I've had enough, and to tell you the truth, I'm relieved.
The sight is dismal, and our affairs from England come too late. Here's a census that should give us hearing, to tell him his commandment is fulfilled. The Rosencrantz and Guildenstern are dead. Where should we have our thanks?
Not from his mouth. Had it the ability of life to thank you. He never gave commandment for the death. So jump upon this bloody question. You from Polack Wars and you from England are here arrived. Give order that these bodies, high upon a stage, are placed into the view, and let me speak to the yet unknowing world of how these things came about. So shall you hear of carnal, bloody, and unnatural acts, of accidental judgments, casual slaughters, of deaths put on by cunning and forced cause. And in this upshot, purposes mistook, fallen on the inventor's head. All this I can deliver.